Good morning. Good morning and welcome to Grace United Methodist Church on this wonderful, blessed Sunday. This time of praise and worship. I know I sound awful, don't I? I feel great, but I think that environmental allergies I have succumbed to. And so laryngitis is plaguing me. So I would invite you to, as you already have, to finish up your conversations and bookmark those so that you can pick it back up on them during our fellowship time after worship over in Grace Hall. because of my lack of voice, I won't be able to sing out these songs, and we do have a new one this Sunday. So we're going to learn it together, right? And we're going to sing it together. And we're going to start out by standing as you feel led and as you're able. And lift your voice and join that with that of the artist for the song Greater. Okay, our tech crew is working. There we go. We've got video going now. We have some audio with it. Okay.
Love him more and more. He's greater. He's greater. The things I lose, the battle braces. It doesn't matter, cause the cross already won.
greater, and he calls me redeemed. He calls us all redeemed. What a blessing. We'll continue on with our next song, which is one that we've sung before and everyone seemed to enjoy, so I thought we'd add it back in. All the people said amen. Amen. Miss Brandy to come and share our time of reflection connection.
Good morning, everybody. All right. So I hear that it's supposed to get kind of nasty this coming week, right? Arctic blast or something like that, that they're saying. So I found this morning and I thought it was fitting for what's coming up. All I need to know about life, I learned from a snowman. It's okay if you're a little bottom heavy. Hold your ground even when the heat is on. Wearing white is always appropriate. Winter is the best of the four seasons. It takes a few extra rolls to make a good midsection. There's nothing better than a foul weather friend. We're all made up of mostly water. You know you've made it when they write a song about you. Happens to be one of my very favorite holiday songs. Accessorize, accessorize, accessorize. Avoid yellow snow. Don't get too much sun. It's embarrassing when you can't look down and see your feet. It's fun to hang out in your front yard. Always put your best foot forward. And the best one, there's no stopping once you're on a roll. Aww. So this entire sermon series has been about mental illness and the awareness and education within our churches and the, you know, impact that it has on all of our lives and all of our church family. And I heard something once that really helped me a lot to understand all kinds of different mental illnesses that people are going through. And you can fill in the blank with anything. I'm going to use Asperger's as an example. If you've met one person with Asperger's, you've met one person with Asperger's. If you've met one person with depression, you've met one person with depression. Everybody's different. Everybody has different symptoms or different ways of dealing. And so just that helped me understand you can't just lump it all in one category and not just one person is the poster child for that specific mental illness. So I keep that in mind in different situations and when I'm learning about things. Okay, I've met one person and this is their story and this is what's happened to them. That doesn't necessarily mean that's how it is for everyone with that diagnosis. Years and years ago, I had this group of friends, group of girlfriends. There was about four or five of us. We'd get together, go have dinner or go see a movie. We would just get together. And this one time, it was actually a little special, a little more of a special weekend. We decided to take a little road trip and we were going to Billings, Montana. We were gonna spend the night, have some dinner, go shopping the next day. It was supposed to be really fun. And we're all in the car, and my friend Val is driving, and her best friend, Tiffany, is next to her. And we're all just in conversation. Y'all women, we can go like over 500 topics in about a minute. So we're covering everything, you know, we can possibly think of, catching up with one another. And Val opens herself up to us a little bit more, and it just really took us by surprise. Now Val, very energetic, perky, one of the happiest people I've ever met. She was our high school mascot. She put that Panther costume on, revved up the crowd at halftime, before and, you know, all throughout during the game, super perky. And so here we are in the car, and she reveals to us that she has depression. It took me by surprise. I was just really shocked. I was like, really? Val? And she reveals that it's something she's been dealing with for a very long time, and she decides that, beyond praying and beyond seeking counsel, she has decided to take that next step and take medication. And we're all just kind of letting this soak in, and her very best friend, Tiffany, right next to her, says, you're just not praying hard enough. It'll go away if you pray hard enough. You're just not praying hard enough or praying enough. I could just feel Val's heart sink. My heart broke for her that this was her best friend's reaction. And here she opened herself up, had this, you know, bit of confidence to reveal to us, and this is the negative reaction she received. There was no convincing Tiffany otherwise that, you know, Val had prayed lots about this. She, you know, definitely wasn't giving up on her faith side. She just really felt she needed an extra step with taking medication. So in private, when there was a moment when it was just Val and I told her, I said, I believe you. I believe you. And she just felt so relieved and just said, thank you so much, because I already feel so bad. I already feel guilty about everything. Thank you so much for believing. And I said, I can't offer you much except for a listening ear, my friendship, and my support. And I think that's all she really was desiring from us anyway. So I've thought about that, how devastating that must have been for her to hear that. And maybe she wouldn't be as open next time to talk to other people about it if that's how her closest friend reacted. And in that way, when I started off talking about if you've met one person with Asperger's, if you met one person with autism, you've met one person with Asperger's, one person with autism. If you've had one friend with a negative reaction, you've had one friend with a negative reaction. That doesn't necessarily mean that's how every single person is gonna react. And I know it's hard to have faith in that when you've felt that rejection. And that's why I thought these next two Bible verses were very fitting. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. Who comforts us in all our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we share abundantly in comfort too. If we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. And if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we suffer. And then Psalm 40, verse 2. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. I hope that that has given some of you some hope and light, and that's my reflection time. Thank you.
Thank you, Brandy. Appreciate all that you've been bringing to us during this sermon series for our Reflection Connection, giving us much to think about and much hope for any of us or any of our loved ones who are dealing with these diagnoses. I myself deal with depression. So that speaks very much to me. And it was through the grace and the help of this community here and particular persons in this congregation who got me onto the path of realizing that it's not a stigma. It's not a bad thing. It's okay to accept that for yourself, admit that to yourself, and to seek help. So, my story. So let's go on with our time of praise and worship. And with this song, let's think about, it's called Breathe. And let's think about how God becomes that air that we breathe.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I will
Amen. That concludes our time of praise and worship, and so I invite Reverend Sandy and Leah to come forward and give our time of announcements.
Well, good morning, and we welcome you to worship at Grace United Methodist Church this morning. We have a very full experience of worship for you today, so buckle up, hang on. And we hope that you do experience God in the midst of it. We have some announcements for you.
All right, as a way to help with our chapel time, and that's every Sunday from 9 to 9:30, we have a variety of things in the baskets here, devotionals, candles, anything that could help enhance your experience in your prayer time with God. It'll just be up here in a basket. If you want to add things to it as well for others, take a look at what's in here and just spend some quiet time with God.
All right, thank you, Leah. You probably noticed when you came in, if you have a mailbox, that you had a flyer in your mailbox. So that was in all of the mailboxes today about our upcoming pictorial directory. So one of these was in each box. Appointment scheduling will begin in Grace Hall after worship today, so make sure that you go check that out if you're headed over to the Fellowship Hall after our service, but you can also book online by following the link that is there on the back of your page. There are two different times that we're scheduling for pictures, and that's Friday, November 28th and Saturday, November 29th, on the Friday and Saturday after Thanksgiving. And if you need alternate times, just talk to Wendy. She'll be knowing more about when other churches might be doing this in their churches later in the fall and winter, and that you might be able to go there if you're going to be out of town during the Thanksgiving holidays or whatever. But definitely come and participate with us. If you have family who's going to be in town and they want to participate as well, they get a free 8x10. And the more people that participate with us, the more benefits we get in our pictorial directory. So have people sign up.
That is awesome. And that's also a really good Christmas gift idea, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And then also our Playground Ministries want to remind you that on December 10th, we're dining to donate at Culver's. So if you are able, please join Yvette in the group as they help to raise some funds to help the ministry. It's such a wonderful ministry.
Dee Melander wants to let us know that she's scheduling some love taxi rides for Pam Palak to get to Davis Hospice. Those who have done the love taxi rides before need to see Dee right after church by the sanctuary doors. So we're trying to make sure that Pam gets over to Davis to see Jeff.
And finally, we do have two Advent Bible study opportunities, one in the morning and one in the evenings on Thursdays. The signups are in the narthex, and so please take a look at that if that's something that's called upon your heart. All right. And now we shift to, do we have birthdays and anniversaries? We do. Awesome. Who's celebrating a birthday on the 10th? It's Charlotte and Mary Lou. So that's wonderful. And then also on the 13th, it's Miss Marty. Wonderful.
Very good. And Gracie's bringing that cake around. And I don't think we've had an anniversary for a while, but we have one this week, November 14th. Sean and Wendy Horton. 22 years, so.
That is awesome.
Happy anniversary to you. We do celebrate with you with your birthdays and anniversaries. And now let us continue with our worship as we turn our heart to God.
Thank you.
please stand for the call to worship? Okay, sorry. Let us worship God, who wants us to love our neighbor as ourselves. The one who is happy or sad. The one whom we understand and the one we don't.
The one who is embraced or the one who is shunned.
The one who is like us or the one who is different. Please remain standing for our opening home. Please be seated, and I invite our children to come forward for children's time.
Just talking, don't mind me, just chatting up here. Okay, so tell me what color an elephant is.
Bluish, grayish.
Have you ever seen an elephant?
Yes.
Like a real elephant?
Yes. Yeah.
Like not in a book? Like a real elephant?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. What color is a pig?
Pink.
Sometimes black and white.
Yeah, sometimes black and white. Yeah. White, yeah. Have you seen a real pig? Yeah?
Yes.
Yeah? Have you seen a real pig? Yeah? Not one in a book?
No.
Yeah?
No.
Yeah? I like to go to the fair and I like to see the pigs. They're huge. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What color is a lion?
A lion?
Brown.
Yellow.
Brown.
Kind of a golden brown, orangish. Yeah. 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 Uh-huh. Yeah. Have you seen a real lion?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
No?
Like.
They?
Like person?
Yeah. Yeah, like in person.
Not that I can remember.
No? Mm-mm. You were at the zoo? You saw a lion at the zoo?
Yeah.
Yeah? Yeah? And there was a nice glass between you and the lion. Okay, that's good. What color is a woozle?
Oh, whatever that is. Oh.
Have you ever seen a woozle?
No.
No? Yeah. What color is a snipe?
A snake usually brown.
Snipe.
Oh,
not a snake. Snipe.
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 Oh, snipe.
Have you ever seen a snipe?
No, I don't know what that is.
Have you ever hunted a snipe? No? Hmm. Some of you have hunted snipe before. I can tell by the way you're giggling. Yes. Okay, so I'll read this part out of the Winnie the Pooh book. "Hello," said Piglet. "What are you doing?" "Hunting," said Pooh. "Hunting what?" "Tracking something," said Winnie the Pooh, mysteriously. "Tracking what?" said Piglet, coming closer. "That's just what I ask myself. I ask myself, what?" What do you think you'll have the answer?" "I shall have to wait until I catch up with it," said Winnie the Pooh. "Now look here," and he pointed to the ground in front of him. "What do you see?" "Tracks," said Piglet. "Paw marks." He gave a little squeak with excitement. "Oh, Pooh, do you think it's a woozle?" With these few words, he went, "Oh, it might be," said Pooh. "Sometimes it is and sometimes it isn't. You can never tell with paw marks." With these words, he went on tracking, and Piglet, after watching him for a minute or two, ran after him. Winnie the Pooh had come to a sudden stop and was bending over the tracks in a puzzled sort of way. "What's the matter?" said Piglet. "It's a very funny thing," said Bear, "but there seems to be two animals now. This whatever it was has been joined by another whatever it is. And the two of them are now proceeding in company. Would you mind coming along with me, Piglet, just in case they turn out to be hostile animals?" Piglet scratched his ear in a nice sort of way and said that he had nothing to do until Friday, and he would be delighted to come in case it really was a woozle. "You mean in case it really is two woozles," said Winnie the Pooh. And Piglet said, anyhow, he had nothing to do till Friday, so off they went together. So they're tracking a woozle, and they don't even know what it is. You guys have seen some animals, and people have described them to you. Even if you've never seen an actual lion, you kind of still know what it is. We don't even know what a woozle looks like, and we're all now curious. They also chase heffalumps, right? Heffalumps and woozles. And they sing a song, and then they go along. And you'll have to read the rest of the story to see if they catch the woozle or not. So, what do you do when you don't know something? How do you find out? Do you track it? How do you track things to figure out what they are? Okay, by their tracks. Yeah, good. How else?
Reading books.
You could look it up in a book,
yeah.
Right? Yep, you can look it up on the internet.
Yeah.
Google, what is a woozle, right? And maybe it'll show a picture of a woozle. How else? You can ask people. Who do you ask? Smart people, like your mom. Yeah? And your grandma.
Very, very,
very smart people.
Yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh. They know things. They know important things, right? And they've lived a long time, so they really know things. Yes. So that's good. And so what happens last week, was it last week or 2 weeks ago, we talked about masks, remember after Halloween, how people hide their face behind things? So what happens if you have a mask where you're like, I know things too, but then have you ever been in class, because sometimes I see this with my students, have you ever been in class and you know you have a question, but you're too embarrassed to ask? You ever been there? You're like, I don't know what a woozle is. Everybody seems to know what's going on, but I don't know. But you're embarrassed because everybody seems to know what a woozle is, and you're there going, mm-mm. I don't think I'm going to ask because I think I'm embarrassed. And I think people will think that I'm not very smart or that I didn't pay attention or I don't know things, right? So you have to figure out who to ask when you are not embarrassed, or if you are embarrassed, who do you go ask? Who are some people that you can go to? Your mom, right? Your dad, your siblings, yeah? And you know what? They might giggle a little and go, oh, you don't know what a woozle is or a snipe? Silly. You know what? They might not know either. Like, I don't know either. Let's go find out together. And then you're going to be like Pooh and Piglet, tromping off, you know, after these paw tracks, because you never can tell with paw tracks if they're going to be heffalumps or if they're going to be woozles or if they're going to be tigers or lions, right? So it's really hard because some people have a real hard time figuring out how to not be embarrassed when they ask questions, especially when it seems like everybody around them knows. And so if you're struggling with something, you can definitely come to your teachers and your friends and all of us around here. We're happy to help you figure out what's going on. Just because we've lived a long time doesn't mean we know everything, but we can definitely be like Pooh Bear and help you figure it out, and Piglet, and go with you. Okay? So think about that as you go on your week, and there's some crazy things that are going on around you. And if you don't know, ask, even if you're embarrassed. Thank you. Bye.
Behold, behold, the mighty one has done great things for me. Behold, behold, the mighty one has done great things for me. Behold, behold, the mighty one has done great things for me.
Thank you so much for bringing that gift of music to us today. Beautiful, beautiful. During this sermon series, we've had a series of videos that we've presented to you, interviews with people either talking about their own mental illness or the mental illness of a loved one. And so today, we watched the video with Maggie Sebastian.
I'm Maggie, and I do have a mentally ill family member. That's my mother. We don't really know how she got mentally ill. No, I never really noticed it until my parents got divorced, and she just started acting really weird. Like, she'd say things like, my old therapist was watching us, and it was just really weird. And she always was convinced that people were following her, and our apartment was bugged, and she used to, like, put smoke detectors down, and then she'd cover them with socks, because she thought that was cameras, and the pipes scratching on the roof were supposedly people crawling around trying to listen to us. It was really strange. It has affected my life, but I don't know. It just kind of made it so I could see the world differently, I guess. Like, I can see, like, the mental illness in people. It sounds really strange and stuff, but I can, like, sense it now because of being around my mom so much. I feel like a lot of people don't really, I don't know, understand it, per se, or pay attention to it much, which is not a bad thing, but it's also not a very good thing. We don't acknowledge it, but people do have issues like that. Like, my mom, people would just completely not notice her at all, which I don't even know how you don't notice that thing. Like, when she says strange stuff like, oh yeah, we're being followed right now, you know? I don't know how people don't notice it. My dad's always been there for me. Luckily, God's been there for me. He's kept me strengthened through all of this. I don't know who's really been there for my mom. I guess I've kind of been there for her. And it's kind of hard being away from her now and under supervision as the only time I can see her. It's not my job, and I know that, but, you know, she's my mom, and I just want to know that she's okay. And her mental illness can probably cause her to do some very strange and not normal things that could cause harm to herself, so it just really worries me a lot of the time. She doesn't get any treatment. That's a hard thing. People have acknowledged that she's mentally ill, and they've court-ordered her to get testing, and she hasn't complied with it, so I'm sure she would be a lot better if she would comply, but she won't. Well, a lot of people don't know this, but I went in treatment a while back when I was like 11 or 12, and it was just a therapy home, and it really just changed my life and how I looked at my mom, and it made me realize that the stuff she was doing wasn't normal like I thought it was. I learned to accept it while I was in therapy, and it really did change my life. Well, honestly, when I was in treatment, like, I got cards every single day from people from this church. And they didn't really know what was going on with me or what was going on with my mom. They probably won't until they see this video. But, honestly, it's not a matter, for me at least, that I don't think they care, because I know that they care. And all those cards and all the kind gifts that people gave me showed me that. Seriously, I have a whole folder full. I saved them. I don't know. I just don't know if people acknowledge it around here or not. I don't think they may or may not. Which is something to work on, I guess. It's kind of hard to be open about it. Like, I even have a hard time being open with it. And I, like, am, like, personally connected to it. I used to honestly think everybody was just judging my mom. And it would make me really angry and defensive about it. Because I'd be like, that's my mom you're talking about. You don't judge my mom for the way she is. It's not okay. And mental illness is just another thing that it's not okay to judge.
Thank you, Maggie. We now have a special presentation.
This is the deck of cards. It was written by T. Texas Tyler. During the North African campaign, a bunch of soldier boys had been on a long hike. They arrived in a little town called Casino, and the next day, being Sunday, several of the boys went to church. After the chaplain read the prayer, the text was taken up. Those of the boys who had prayer books took them out, but one boy had only a deck of cards, so he spread them out. The sergeant who commanded the boys saw the cards and said, "Soldier, put away those cards." After the service was over, the soldier was taken prisoner and brought before the provost marshal. The marshal said, "Sergeant, why have you brought this young man here?" "For playing cards in church, sir." "And what have you to say for yourself, son?" "Much, sir," the soldier replied. The marshal said, "I hope so, for if not, I shall punish you severely." The soldier said, "You see, sir, I have been on the march for 6 days and had neither Bible nor prayer book, but I hope to satisfy you, sir, with the purity of my intentions. You see, sir, when I look at the ace, it reminds me that there is but one God. And when I see the deuce, it reminds me that the Bible is divided into two parts, the Old and the New Testaments. And when I see the tree, I think of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And when I see the four, I think of the four evangelists who preached the gospel. They were Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And when I see the five, it reminds me of the five wise virgins who trimmed their lamps. There were 10 of them. Five were wise and were saved. Five were foolish and were shut out. And when I see the six, it reminds me that in 6 days, God made this great heaven and earth. And when I see the seven, it reminds me that on the seventh day, God rested. And when I see the eight, I think of the eight righteous persons God saved when he destroyed this earth. There was Noah and his wife, and their three sons, and their wives. And when I see the nine, I think of the lepers our Savior cleansed, and 9 of the 10 didn't even thank him. When I see the 10, I think of the 10 commandments God handed Moses on the table of stone. And when I see the king, it reminds me once again, there is but one King of heaven, God Almighty. And when I see the Queen, I think of the Blessed Virgin Mary, who is Queen of heaven. And the Jack, or Knave, the devil. And when I count the number of spots on a deck of cards, I find 365, the number of days and a year. There are 52 cards, the number of weeks and a year. There are 13 tricks, the number of weeks and a quarter. There are 4 suits, the number of weeks and a month. There are 12 picture cards, the number of months in a year. So you see, sir, my deck of cards has served me as a Bible, almanac, and a prayer book. And friends, this story is true, for I was that soldier.
we continue our honoring of veterans with another special presentation.
I just want to say thank you. Thank you for the way you fight for me. Oh, for all that you've given, for all you've had to give, for every single sacrifice you've made so America could live in freedom today, to give hope in place of sorrow, know that your courage this day secures our freedom for tomorrow. Sacrifice you've made so America could live in freedom today, to give hope in place of sorrow, know that your courage this day is making a difference for our tomorrow. You're making for me, and I just want to say thank you. I just want to say thank you.
Invite all who are Army, or not just Army, but military veterans here in our sanctuary to stand, please. We do thank you. Juliana, I was hoping maybe you'd come help me really quick. Can you come up here? Several years ago, for our Veterans Day celebration, we handed out some little American flag pins to all of those who are veterans, but we haven't done it in a few years. So if you're a veteran and you don't have a little pin to put on your name tag to let us know that you're veterans, raise your hand and Juliana will bring one to you. Thank you, Juliana. Were there any others? Okay. And you can just leave it in the back, sweetie. Okay. While she's doing that, we do want to just give you another thank you for your service. As we move into our time of prayer, I'd like to lift up all of those on this Veterans Day who have served for our country, and also following up on our video for all of those who have family members or who that they themselves have mental illness. For our prayer time, we have others, many others, to add and recognize for our list. We have been lifting up Jeff Palick, who is now at Davis Hospice. He has been moved to room 12, is that correct? So instead of 7, as you might have seen. If you do need to go visit, make sure your visit is very short to conserve his strength. But we are asking for special prayers for Pam and for the whole family as they're going through tough times right now. Also, we are celebrating that Marilyn Everett got to go home from 5 months in rehab. She wants to let you know phone calls are welcome, so if you'd like to call Marilyn, she would appreciate that. We continue to pray for Doris, who is Fred Drake's aunt, for Judy, who is Glenda's sister, for Wilbur and Jane Craig, who are friends of Ron and Linda Summers, for Jim Sisko, who is a friend of Zach Shelton, for Neil Greer, who is Sherry's 91-year-old uncle, for Carol, who is Juanita Pennington's daughter-in-law. She did get a report from Mayo, as their doctors in Kansas City is home and she will be on oxygen from here on out. So that's the report. Also, prayers for Missy, friend of Maggie Sebastian. Were there any other prayer cards that I missed? As we move into our time of prayer, just remember that we're doing things a little bit differently during this sermon series, that Leah will come up and she will offer our morning prayer. And then we will have a time of a sung response. You'll see the music on the screen. At that time when we sing, if you would like to come forward and use the kneeling rails to pray or for meditation, please feel free to do so. If, while you're at that kneeling rail, you would like someone to come and pray with you silently, we ask you to just reach out your hands and kind of have them open in front of you. Someone will come and hold your hand. When you are finished praying, just squeeze their hand and they will release your prayer. If you want to pray by yourself, just keep your hands folded in front of you. And then when you hear the Lord's Prayer, that will just be your signal to then go back to your seats. So we continue to turn our hearts to God in prayer.
Will you all pray with me? Loving God, we give thanks for the amazing and colorful fall that we have experienced, and we now prepare for the transition to a new season, a season of snow and a season of cold. As one season ends and a new one begins, let us be grateful and mindful that it is you who provides new life each day. You also remind us that change can be beautiful, as beautiful as the shimmering of the morning sun of a frost-covered tree limb. Lord, we confess that we don't always see you in our world today. We are blind by the anxieties of our work. We are blinded by the anxieties of our relationships. Pressure of this world weighs heavily in our lives, limiting our ability to share love with others. We struggle to forgive others, keeping us bound and in bondage to the past. We struggle to maintain control, keeping us from being open to your plan. Give us the courage and the boldness to call out to you, God. Give us strength in our faithfulness and your call upon our lives, even though your plan may not be clear to us. Let our eyes and our attitudes be open and renewed to new possibilities as we grow and become transformed by your love. We have confidence that you are aware of the joys and the concerns that pulsate throughout our hearts. Lord, we ask for your strength as we have those who are in relationships that are difficult, and for those who may be struggling with losses in their lives. But we also give thanks for those who are recovering from surgeries or medical procedures. And provide your hope for those who are living in the shadows of grief. Be with those who we serve in the Park Squad Playground Ministry, because we know, Lord, that the temperatures will be plummeting this week. And loving God, we celebrate this Veterans Day, and we give thanks to all the men and women who have served in our country. We give thanks to all the men and women who have served right here in Cheyenne, whatever military branch they're in. And Lord, we thank you for them and their work to help us be free. Father God, we come to you longing for your presence. We come to you with a desire to love as you love us. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us with the confidence of children. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from Mark 10, verses 46 to 52. They came to Jericho. As he and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. The word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Holy God, send your spirit upon us, that as your scripture has been read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what it is you have to say to us this day. Amen. Eeyore is always gloomy. He loses his tail. But Pooh finds it. On Eeyore's birthday, there is no party. But Pooh and Piglet give him presents. Even his house makes him sad. One day, it is gone. Pooh and Piglet have moved it to the other side of the forest. Eeyore even gets bounced into the river, but Piglet helps him dry off. Cheer up, Eeyore. You have the best friends in all the world. August 11th, 2014, kind of rocked our society, our American society at least, a little bit, when we learned of the suicide death of Robin Williams. And as hard as it is to hear of any suicide, I think a lot of questions came up when we heard of Robin Williams' suicide. And I think that often there are more questions than answers. And as tragic as it is, I am glad for the questions. And I'm glad for the ways that, at least for a burst of time, media was talking about depression, was talking about mental illness, was talking about the reality of suicide. But I think probably a lot of the questions that we would have if we are people who have never experienced depression or mental illness would be questions like, why in the world would someone like Robin Williams commit suicide? What in the world would he have in his life to be so sad about, right? And maybe a deeper question of just, how does someone get into such a dark place in their lives? And for those of us who have never experienced depression, we probably don't have any way to connect with any of those experiences. I think there are absolutely more questions than there are answers. But the answer as to why for Robin Williams obviously rests in the reality of mental illness. That he was suffering deep depression, probably in connection with Parkinson's disease, right? And that he came to a very, very dark place. that on the outside, it might not be easy for us to see why he would have gotten to such a place. And this book called Darkness is My Only Companion by Catherine Green McCrate, she talks about her own manic side and depression, and a Christian response to it. But here's what she says in a chapter called Darkness Again. This is her own experience. After mania, because she is manic depressive, after mania comes the darkness again. The doctor's medicine has managed to build a ceiling for the mania to keep me from traveling too high, but there is as yet no floor for the depression. I am in the sub-basement, bungeed from high to low. With the darkness, I experience visions and voices. This is true of mental patients from time to time. But the stigma of mental illness, including the jokes made by the healthy about the ill, is worse than the visions and voices. At least the visions and voices teach me something about myself and about God. But the stigma teaches me nothing except about the proclivity of humanity to harm humanity. Working despite the realities of this stigma, there are many who have suffered mental illness and yet were and are prodigious in their fields. This gives me hope. I want to be one of those prodigious ones as well, despite the stigma of mental illness. I've done a lot of reading over the past several months to try to understand as best I can, at least up until this point, about mental illness and to be able to share something that might, I don't know, be helpful. One thing I do remember reading about depression was that if you are a loved one of someone who has depression, one thing that you don't want to do is to go up to them and say, you know what, I've been sad too. Because if you have never had depression, you have no idea what the depths are of the illness. So recently I was in a conversation with someone and they just kind of asked me, so what is it for you that kind of sets off your depression, or what is depression like for you? Because as I've shared with you before, I do take medication for my own depression. And even though I've been successfully medicated for at least a decade, I've been on and off medication for probably about 17 or 18 years. And so when I kind of thought about that, I thought, wow, I don't know that anybody's ever asked me before what my experience about that has been. It's really a very private thing in some ways. But so I had to think about it a little bit. And it does seem to be like a far thing from me right now, because it's been at least a decade since I've had a really depressive episode, because my medications work very well for me. And I know when I start feeling a little bit depressed, I know there are things that I can do that help me stay healthy, like continue to get on the treadmill every day, even though I hate it, right? And not to take naps every day, sleeping kind of, even though it's a joy for me, I love to sleep. If I start napping too much, it becomes a coping mechanism rather than something that's just, you know, a luxury, I guess. So I was trying to think, but man, when I start thinking about it, it seems like it's right there. And so, you know, the question, what might set it off or what might send you into depression, is the answer of nothing and everything. That on this side of my depression, it doesn't make sense. Me right now being happily medicated, I look back and I think, well, goodness. You know, there's really no logical reason for me to have felt depressed. There's no no rationality to it. Really, it doesn't make a lot of sense. All I know is that when I've been depressed, it has been so heavy and so dark. And so what I like to say about my medication is that before medication, my emotions controlled me. And after my medication, I am able to control my emotions. But I can remember times being so filled with self-loathing that it doesn't make sense. But man, it was present. And then it didn't really matter what I did, nothing made me happy about myself. And sometimes that would make me react and act out in different ways to other people. It's a spiral down, at least for me, this is my experience, that, you know, it didn't matter the pep talks that I would try to give myself, or even what somebody else might want to come say to me, you know, cheer up. It almost made me feel worse to hear stuff like that. Because when you hear it, you're like, yeah, I should just feel better. But you can't, or at least I couldn't. And so it made me feel worse. And then you hear something, well, just, you know, you can be happy and it will all be okay and da-da-da-da, snap out of it. And then you say that and you're like, yeah, but you can't, and so you feel worse. And you can't, and you can't. And can't. And there's an inability to be able to talk yourself or even pray your way out of this dark, dark place. I am happy, happy that there is such a thing as medication and that I've been able to get on medication that works for me. I know that lots of people struggle finding the right one, finding the right dosage, finding the right balance of treatment options available. And for me, just having my pill is good. And sometimes I think, man, yeah, it's just silly. I don't know why I would have felt that way. But, you know, recently our insurance kind of switched over home delivery providers for medication. I had a few days lapse, and I totally remembered why I can't do it by myself. If you've never experienced depression, you really don't know the depths. And if you have, and you're on the other side, it's even hard to remember what it was like. You just have to know that saying, cheer up, is probably not going to help. But that help is needed. Help is needed. I'm so struck by the story of blind Bartimaeus. Now, he's blind, and if this is a story that I've heard, you know, forever. I mean, we've all heard this 100 times, right? This story of the gentleman that was blind, he was calling out, nobody listened to him, and then Jesus does, right? But I was thinking about this particular story in the context of this mental illness sermon series. It took on a whole new dimension. And I thought about those who have mental illness and who cry out. And sometimes those with mental illness cry out in a lot of different ways. Sometimes it's in healthy ways, and sometimes it's in very unhealthy ways, because they are not healthy. And you know, the disciples were there to tell Bartimaeus, shh, we don't want that. We don't need that. Just hush. Kind of, Jesus doesn't have time for this. We've heard you before. We know what's going on, the rolling of the eyes, so just sit there and hush. And Bartimaeus just calling out, help me. Help me. help me. Because of stigma in our society and definitely other societies, people who have needed help and who have needed to call out for help and maybe are calling out for help are shushed. Shh. We've heard that before. We know you. Rolling of the eyes. Hush. And yet as Jesus walks by, Jesus listens and reaches out and acknowledges the help that is needed. So during this sermon series, my real hope is to raise awareness about mental illness, right? We've talked about my favorite statistic that says, not my favorite, but the one that I keep repeating, 1 in 4, Sherry knows it, 1 in 4 people suffer from mental illness or a mental illness episode within a year. 1 in 4. So look around. We've got more than 4 people. So we probably had some episodes, and we probably have some chronic mental illness going on. And yet the stigma in our society has shushed it. And even our church has shushed it. You know, I can't, yeah, Levon, I didn't quite say that right, did I? You know, just have faith. Christians are joyful. Just pray, right? Harder, pray harder. And so for those of you I know who have experienced mental illness, you probably get me, right? You're getting what I'm talking about. But there are others of you who are saying, what in the world are we supposed to do then? We do not understand. I think that's the first place to start, is to know that you may not understand, but that sure doesn't mean you can't love. And that, yeah, sometimes being in relationship with someone with mental illness can be difficult. It can be hard, and it can be frustrating. So the National Alliance on Mental Illness, if you ever want to go and Google NAMI, N-A-M-I, that stands for the National Alliance on Mental Illness, or you can go to www.nami.org. I found some tips there for coping with either a family member or a friend with mental illness. So I just want to read a few for you, that this might kind of give you a little bit of something to hold on to, because I think there's a lot of questions around how are we in good, healthy relationships with those who have mental illness, even if we have mental illness ourselves, right? We still need to be in good, healthy relationships with others who are have mental health, and for those who have are coping with issues. So under the basic principles, it says, just remember these things. You cannot cure a mental disorder for someone you love. You can't. No one is to blame for the one you love developing the disorder. No one's to blame. It is important to learn to separate the disorder and its symptoms from the person that you love. If you feel anger and resentment, direct that negative energy toward the illness, not toward the person that you love. Under a section called Strategies and Realities, it says this: psychotic symptoms such as hallucinations and delusions have little or nothing to do with reality, so it is not beneficial to discuss them with your family member or try to talk them out of a belief that it was the result of disturbed thinking. So just saying, cheer up, it's not that bad. You would never try to fix a biological disorder such as diabetes or high blood pressure with talk. Acknowledge the remarkable courage and strengths that your loved one may show when dealing with a mental disorder. Unusual and uncharacteristic behavior is a symptom of the disorder, so don't take it personally. Don't be afraid to ask your sibling or parent or friend if he or she is thinking about hurting himself or herself. The possibility of suicide is a real concern, and asking about it will not give them ideas. See if they have a safety plan to address the concerns. And then there's a whole section on self-care of those who love friends or family with mental illness. Be sure to prioritize your own self-care. Exercise, get good rest, get good nutrition, have loving relationships, have spiritual or religious support, other support groups, hobbies. Those are common avenues to support self-care. Remember that you are not a paid caseworker. You're not a professional. You're a parent, or you're a sibling, or you're a child, or you're a friend. Not a caseworker. This is important. The needs of the ill person do not always have to come first. Often it's just not possible. It is important to establish boundaries and to set clear limits for you. And it's very, very natural for you to experience a variety of emotions such as grief, guilt, fear, anger, sadness, hurt, confusion, and more. And know that you are the only one in charge of your own feelings. And if you need to get some help or have someone to talk to with those feelings or emotions, do it. Do it. I think it's important to know that unless you've experienced it, you probably won't understand. And if you don't experience mental illness, you don't have to understand. But you are asked to love. You are asked to listen. And you are asked to help find ways to support the people that you love with mental illness. So before I began this sermon series, I knew of people in our congregation that had mental illness, but I don't think I'd ever said, "So what's it like?" until I sat down for these videos. And it's been a journey of growth and learning of courage and great spirits of wonderful people in our congregation. But I'd never asked before. And so I invite you, if you know someone with mental illness, for so long they have been taught to not say anything and to keep that private. That's shh. We don't need to hear that. Even if we know, we're not going to talk about that because that's not something we talk about. I invite you to not be like the disciples, but maybe follow in the footsteps of Jesus. And when you hear the cry, and before you hear the cry, to just reach out and say, "What's it like? Tell me about your experience. Tell me how you are coping. I will listen. Maybe I won't understand, but I'm here, and I'd like to help." And I think if maybe we can do that as a community of faith with one another, we will create the kind of community that God would want us to be. Not hushing anyone, but listening and reaching out in love. I pray these have been the words of the Lord for us this day. Amen. Please stand and let us join together in our closing hymn.
Thank you.
as you're standing, I invite you to reach out your hand to those around us. Don't let us stand alone, but let us be connected as the body of Christ in this place. And as you go from this place, may the love of God, the grace and peace of Jesus the Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, now and forever. Amen.